May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my strength and redeemer. Once upon a time, there was a young man who was going to school to become a lawyer. And one night, one dark and stormy night, as he was traveling, he was caught in a violent thunderstorm in which lightning struck a large tree nearest to where he was on the road. The tree's large and heavy branch came down and nearly pinned him and his horse to the ground, killing both of them. So then the young man interpreted this as a kind of conversion experience, his own St. Paul moment, recalling the conversion of Saul, who would later become Paul, on his way to Damascus. And the young man then decided to leave his studies and his endeavors in the law and become a monk, dedicating his life to God and to the mission of the church. Now that story should sound familiar. To whom am I talking about? Martin Luther. Very good, very good. I didn't actually learn that story until seminary, but I probably should have known it sooner. So I'm referring to Martin Luther, who left the legal profession or preparing for the legal profession to become an Augustinian friar. And he'd later go on to be ordained, and he became a professor of theology at the university in Wittenberg, which was, at the time, in the early 16th century, that was a new university. So that was a pretty big deal for him to go there. And of course, the rest is history, the story that we all know well. Now, whether it's St. Paul's road to Damascus story from the book of Acts, or Luther's similar experience as a young man, today's gospel reading, or baptism, the theme of vocation, being called by God into relationship, community, and mission, is one which concerns all of God's human creation, and it's the reason for our being, as well as our life as God's church. Just as God the Son called Simon, Andrew, James, and John to discipleship, learning from their rabbi and participating in his mission, so too does God continue to call us as disciples for the sake of God's world, to which we proclaim the gospel in both word and in deed. Now at its face, today's reading, it produces a lot of questions. I know I still have had a lot of questions whenever I read the gospel text for today. Questions such as, why did Jesus choose to call Simon and Andrew, as well as James and John, to discipleship? That is, there must have been other men out in their boats fishing, casting their nets, and pulling in the lines. Why did Jesus ask them to abandon their responsibilities? And in the case of James and John, their father Zebedee, leaving him in the boat with the hired workers. I don't know about you, but that kind of sounds like a violation of the fourth commandment, you know, that whole thing about honoring your mother and father. No doubt the call to a young man to learn from a religious teacher or figure to be prepared for the priestly office of Sadducee or Pharisee, it must have been a vocation which was highly regarded. But everything seems so urgent in today's reading. There's little time for Jesus to explain things, and the author of our text doesn't really explain things either. All we get is Jesus' declaration of, come and follow me. Now, as Lutherans, despite Martin Luther's dramatic story of a call to the mission work of the church, it's often difficult for us to talk about Christian vocation as a dramatic conversion experience. Most of us weren't called to the life of faith that is the church through encountering Jesus on the shores of the Galilee, being blinded on the way to Damascus, or nearly being killed in a thunderstorm. Quite frankly, short of associating such dramatic and powerful experiences with the lives of prominent saints, I'm a little skeptical of conversion experiences in general. I guess that's just because I'm such a dyed-in-the-wool Lutheran. But, you know, as Lutherans, we do understand the call to discipleship and Christian life in and through baptism, that most ancient of the church's rites in which we encounter God in and through the water and the word that is the sacrament, and quite often and normatively as infants. Discipleship, though, being called to be a student and follower of Jesus, as well as children of God, be it through the encounter with him on the shores of the Galilee or through baptism, it produces a kind of tension, what we might call a dichotomy, between the old and the new. In the case of Simon, Andrew, James, and John, it looked like a leaving of something behind for the sake of a calling. And for us, and I'm going to use the language of St. Paul here, it's a daily dying to sin and resurrection in Christ. And just how the church has and how the church continues to respond to this call to discipleship is a most profound and serious question. The history of the early church, for instance, prior to the Roman Emperor Constantine, so we're talking like, you know, the first couple centuries, that history, it's saturated with the blood of the martyrs. Martyr itself just means witness. These were men and women who died in and for the faith of the church, imitating the life of Christ through asceticism and execution. During the medieval period, of which Luther was a product, truly faithful discipleship often meant a retreat from the world, into the monastery, into the convent, or the priestly office, in which vows of celibacy and poverty were taken and observed, an imitation of Christ. In fact, one of the most popular writings in the Middle Ages was a book by Thomas a Kempis called Imitation of Christ. And you know, today there are many faith traditions within the larger church who understand this call to discipleship as a complete break with the world and the larger society around them. We need only think about our friends and brothers and sisters in the faith, the Amish, for instance. You know, they're one of those groups. Now, getting back to the text for this morning, I don't know why Jesus chose Simon, why he chose Andrew, James, and John for discipleship. And we can, of course, speculate, as I did a little bit earlier, that there must have been others present whom he could have called. But for whatever reason, Jesus chose those four people. Today's reading does, and I think appropriately so, call to mind matters of call, matters of vocation, and matters of discipleship. But just like the prior readings from the last two Sundays, and also like the subsequent readings in which we're going to encounter, which are going to conclude on Transfiguration Sunday, the prominent theme of today's reading is that of Epiphany, the revelation of Jesus of Nazareth's divine nature as God the Son. The encounter of the four fishermen with Jesus isn't just that of four men with a rabbi or a religious figure, but an encounter with God incarnate. Just as the Word was capable of bringing creation into being, so too is the Christ able to call the four fishermen into immediate discipleship through his command, "Come and follow me." This is an encounter with the divine in which the lives of Simon, the life of Andrew, James, and John are forever changed. To be more precise and true to our text, our reading for today, Jesus' command to Simon and Andrew, and probably something similar to James and John too, it's, "Come and follow me and I will make you fishers of people." Now I know in our reading today it says fishers of men, or fish for people, which when I hear that I think, you know, pal, you're mackerel. And he turns them into salmon or, you know, whatever fish are in the Sea of Galilee. But it's, "Come and follow me and I will make you fishers of people." You get the idea. And that's all that he says. There's a lot more which Jesus could have said, but that was enough. I think to paraphrase it, it's as if Jesus is saying, "I am calling you, and you'll follow me, and call others to follow also." For those four men, for Simon, Andrew, James, and John, their call to discipleship looked like encountering God the Son on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, in which they heard and responded to his command to come and follow him, as students would to a rabbi. For St. Paul and Martin Luther, this call to discipleship looked like a conversion experience, in which their lives were radically and dramatically reoriented. For the martyrs and for medieval Christians, discipleship meant an imitation of Christ, in which they embraced self-denial and they retreated from the world. And that's similar to the call of discipleship for many other people today. And for us Lutherans, we understand the call to discipleship through our understanding of baptism, that means of grace instituted by God the Son, in which we too encounter God, edified and perpetually transformed by the Holy Spirit and joined to Christ. This call to discipleship, it isn't merely for our own benefit, but rather it's the reason for our creation, so that we can be called into relationship and community with God as God's church, for the sake of God's redeemed and perpetually healing creation. And to that end, God has not only called us to discipleship in and through baptism, but also various gifts, various occupations. To use the language of Luther and Philip Melanchthon, what they would call estates. These estates are those things in which we participate in God's ongoing work of reconciliation through trades, through occupations, through the vocation of being a father or a mother. The work of the farmer, the truck driver, or the parent being just as sacred and necessary for God's human creation as that of the minister or the priest. God has called us to discipleship through baptism and continues to call us through the Word as well as the Holy Meal of Communion, wherein we not only hear the good news of atonement and forgiveness in the Eucharistic prayer, but also in the words given for you, but we also receive the very real body and blood of Christ, the same Christ who first called Simon, Andrew, James, and John, and who calls us and all people to discipleship, edifying, building up our faith, keeping us in grace, and strengthening us for the holy work of God's church, for the sake of the world of which we are a part. Amen.